Welcome to this Ex Illis demo. This video will give you an overview of the game and its functionalities. An important part of the Ex Illis experience takes place on the website in between battles. Here we can see the different units a player has in his collection. We can have a closer look at a unit by simply clicking on its frame, and from there you can rename a unit to your liking, see the different skills it possesses, and specialize it in a precise branch as it develops. In Ex Illis, creating a new muster or modifying an existing one can be done in the nick of time. The game uses an advanced system which enables strategical flexibility while ensuring a good balance between forces. To add a unit to a muster, you simply need to click on its image. You can refine its value within the army by adjusting its level or by removing miniatures from the unit. Once the musters are created on the website, you can start playing the game by launching the software. When you log on to it, the player's musters are uploaded to your device, and at this point, an internet connection is no longer needed. The first step consists in setting the game options which you want to use. Then each player chooses the muster he plans on using. The second step is the terrain preparation. To place a terrain feature, you can drag it onto the specific zone or onto the random button. Once the terrain is defined, the armies can be deployed. The players can place a unit in the first row in front of them. Each player can deploy up to 3 units in the same zone. The more troops are located in a zone, the stronger they will be in melees. However, they will also be an easy target to enemy fire. Ex Illis uses an initiative system to activate units. The first units to be deployed have the disadvantage of revealing their position to the enemy, but they will also act first. The order of deployment is therefore an important part of the strategy. Another major aspect to consider is the presence of terrain features on the battlefield. Obstacles protect from enemy fire and charges. In wooded areas, there can only be 2 units per square, and the cavalry charge bonus is cancelled. Here are a few of the main units found in the starter kit. The Francs Chevaliers form a heavy cavalry unit whose charge can be devastating for almost any enemy. The long bowmen are archers who can shoot quickly. They must, however, pay attention to their level of fatigue in order to remain accurate. Imps are small casters who can deal tremendous damage to enemy troops but are particularly fragile. The relation between the physical game and the software is the following. The gaming board and the miniatures represent the general's view, the tactical view. It shows the location of your troops and that of the enemy, as well as the presence of terrain features and other similar information. As for the software, it shows the soldier's perspective of the battlefield. It doesn't show the big picture. It is only used to give units precise orders, like what technique to use or what parry to try. At the top of the screen, you can see the turn bar. It indicates in which order the units will be activated. This list varies according to the deployment order, each unit's speed, its level of fatigue, and the length of some actions. An encyclopedia of the game is available to help you at any time. You can click on the question mark and then on an element of the interface to get more information. The lower left corner shows the health gauge. It indicates the level of fatigue, the level of life, and the level of veil. The more fatigued a unit is, the slower, the more imprecise, and the more sensitive to moral changes it becomes. It is therefore important to use the right units against the right enemy in order not to fatigue your troops in vain. Likewise, it is interesting to send your less expensive troops against the enemy elite to simply tire it. The action bar at the bottom of the screen shows every order the unit can execute for this turn. It is the strategic and tactical decisions you make while playing which seals the victory. The game starts with the activation of the Francs Chevaliers, who are deployed first. The player decides to move his cavalry 1 zone diagonally to remain out of the enemy cavalry and Billman's reach. Yet, he still poses a threat since he can charge on the next turn. However, he exposes himself to enemy fire. The second player has no choice but to respond to the enemy's advance if he doesn't want to face a heavy cavalry charge. In order to take a strategic position, he moves his billmen forward in a forest where they will be both protected by the terrain feature and in a good position to attack at the right moment. The first player knows he will have to dislodge the enemy infantry from the forest where they hold a strong position. Thus, he orders his Marin to cast a wind spell to weaken the enemy. As for her retinue of arbalestier, it improves its next shot by adding an electric charge to it. The software calculates the damage received by each miniature according to its elemental resistance. The hobelars dash into the woods where they will be sheltered from the arbalestier's shots. From this position, they'll be able to charge the heavy cavalry's flank back to the Franc Chevaliers. The first player now has the opportunity to charge several targets. Feeling reckless, he decides to launch an attack against the billmen into the forest. This charge amounts to jumping into the lion's den. But sometimes, the best defense is a good offense. Let's have a look at this combat sequence in detail. When a fight occurs, duels are formed for each attack. The statistics of both protagonists are used to determine the results. Clicking on one of the duels is equivalent to rolling a die, which takes into account a large number of parameters. The animation that follows shows the damage suffered. Rather than risking shooting his own troops, the second player rushes his longbowmen into the fight. He knows that his archers will deal little damage, but he hopes that the opponent thus outnumbered will flee. Unfortunately, the elite cavalry defends itself well against the charge, and thanks to its strong morale, the Franc Chevalier unit obstinately refuses to yield ground. Possibly inspired by the enemy's last move, the first player decides to rush his arbalestier at the enemy hobelars. The game goes on for a few turns during which the opponents exchange blows. The melees thicken while spells and arrows rain down on warriors. The light cavalry decides to escape its opponents in order to attempt a new charge, but they end up paying a high price for attacking enemies in a defensive position. The Sofrances manage to join the main melee. However, they suffer serious damage from the Billman's attack. Everything now seems to come down to this fight between the heavy cavalry and the monsters on the one side, and the longbowmen, the Billmen, and the angelic hero on the other. After a few exchanges, the Billmen and the Decurion manage to deal a decisive blow to the main melee. Both Sofrances and two Franc Chevaliers fall at the same time. What's left of the heavy cavalry panics and runs away, which wipes out the first player's close combat striking power. It looks like the outcome of the battle takes shape. The second player ends up with three choices. Attack the Vilaine, a peasant unit which doesn't appear to represent a great threat, go hot on the heels of the Marin, or take a moment to rest a little. Confident since his last victory, he chooses the third option. This decision is the tactical error that will cost him victory. By staying in place, the second player neglects the power of the enemy Marin, who, with her spells, finishes off several warriors who were wounded in the last melee. The second player realizes that the more he will leave the Marin and her arbalestier alone, the more they will cause damage within his ranks. He thus decides to chase after enemy shooters, but splits up his troops in order not to offer an easy target. The first player sees a golden opportunity in this move. After sending his arbalestier to the attack, he uses his Vilaine to charge the last Billman and the Decurion from the rear. These peasants might not be the most courageous or the strongest in combat, but the rear charge is devastating. The Billman, who was already wounded, succumbs. The angelic hero is trapped by the enemy. A little reinforcement attempts to save him, but it's too little, too late. After fighting bravely and taking down several enemies with him, the Decurion, wounded and exhausted, finally perishes from the blows. Thus, the game ends with the first player's victory. The battle report is automatically sent to Ex Illis servers, and both players' units gain the appropriate experience. Chances are the next games between these two players will be much different, since the development and specializations of their units will give new strategic possibilities.